brought into this plot to talk about the events of 25 years ago. We're remembering that at that time, you know, many of us remember that there were, what an active time it was in the life of our community, where everybody was challenged to observe and to make a decision on this very important treasure to our city. And here we are perched on the brink of it today as a result of the efforts of a lot of people, including many in this room, and of course many architects at that time were involved, including several who are speaking with us today. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Bob Kovalenko, who's the chair of the Historic Resources PIA, who assembled this program and the exhibit here that marks this great occasion 25 years ago. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Margaret. I'd like to start out by introducing our panel. We've got Jerry Thome, Arnie Bystrom, FAIA, Vic Colton, FAIA, Terry Sugarman, and George Barkowitz, who's up from Mexico, and Bruce Chapman on the panel. Start out with Jerry Thome. He's going to talk a little bit about the Friends of the Market, the writing of the initiative to save the market on the ballot, and how the initiative prepared for the DCD adopted plan in 23. So, Jerry, do you want to get this off?
Okay. This is a distinguished group here, and it's nice to see them all again. They have a lot to insight into what's been happening in the market in the last 25 years. I could talk a long time about how the initiative came to be and about the ins and outs, but I think obviously there isn't really enough time to go into a lot of details, so I'll just kind of skim the surface if you don't mind. I know we're competing with the Corporate Council for the Arts and the annual meeting here, annual lunch here today, so I'm sure that some of our friends and people that have been very interested in the market over the years have to go to that other event. I was not present at the beginning of the Friends of the Market, which I believe was organized in about 1964. I do understand, however, that the Friends of the Market came into being shortly after the Central Association was formed. Central Association was the first name of the organization of downtown business people. And they did organize in the early 1960s, and one of their first actions was to persuade the city government that the market was a blight on the city and a very poor use of a very valuable view real estate. So the wheels began to turn within the downtown business community and the city government, which in those days were close to being identical, I felt. And the arrow was pointed at the market. And very soon a plan was developed. A plan developed by some very eminent, good, qualified, thoughtful architects in the city, Paul Kirk and John Morris, to develop a plan for saving the market, which would have involved a, as I recall it, 49-story hotel in Virginia.
Okay.
A 3,000-car garage and a vast office complex in a small area that would have been set aside for market uses, which people at that time said would be just as nice as the Los Angeles Farmers Market. So, and would attract just as many people. So that was the beginning of that movement. Well, as you all know, Victor Steinberg and friends, mostly architects, I think, at the beginning, and later on, broader segment of the community, began to meet under the auspices of Allied Arts, and held a few fundraisers at Lowell's, champagne breakfast, to bring people's attention to this threat against the market, and ultimately spun off from Allied Arts and became a group called the Friends of the Market. The initial chairmen of the Friends of the Market were Bob Ashley and Victor Steinberg, and later on Mr. Ashley left the group in a disagreement over some development plans. And also in the meantime, a smaller group of downtown business people, headed by a lawyer named William Ferguson and a furniture store owner named Gus Gosees, and architect named William Bates Sr., organized a group called Pike Plaza
Associates, I think.
But there was a park in there. Pike Plaza Park Associates or something. And their group, their purpose was to acquire a property within the market. They eventually acquired 50% of the property within the market and become the developer of choice when they heard the renewal came along, which everyone was certain would come. So we had a long series of hearings in front of the city council. In the meantime, Victor succeeded in, Victor, probably many of you had the privilege to know him, was an indomitable advocate and a tireless worker in support of the market. And he succeeded in getting the marketplace on the National Register of Historic Places about this time. And that created a lot of distress among the developers and urban renewal people and the city and downtown. And they eventually were so distressed that they had a meeting at the Rainier Club with Charles Odegaard, who was head of the state historic preservation office at the time, and they reduced the preservable and historic part of the market from, I guess, about 11 acres to 1.5 acres. So that was, but that was an important aspect. Well, then we had a long series of hearings in front of the city council, presented 50,000 signatures on a petition to save the market, and eventually the city council voted that I recall overwhelmingly to proceed with the urban renewal plan. So at that time, the Friends of the Market, who were meeting weekly in Fred Pacetti's office, I had to decide what to do, and there was a contingent of people that thought we should take a legal attack. There was a contingent that thought we should just have an initiative that said no to urban renewal, and there was a contingent of a group that thought that the best way would be to have an initiative that declared it a historic district and tried to use the urban renewal procedures and funds that were available. And that was the view that prevailed. I guess I just will say, and I don't want to go on too long, that in those days, this of course would have been 1971, the issue wasn't, these directions were not that clear. So our historic district has resulted from a rather close vote in a series of meetings among people that had different thoughts about how to keep the market. Anyway, we decided to do the initiative, and I'm really very happy to pass down the vote. But the initiative was, we didn't have a lot of patterns to follow for the initiative. There had not been many public initiatives initiative, part of the initiative was written by the city government, which they did not realize. Departments was sympathetic to her cause, as Ed Sigler, and he selected a young man in his office to research historic districts around the states and the city of Bryan. So among the four of us, we did get an initiative drafted and filed in time. It wasn't too much trouble getting signatures for it, and the campaign. Campaign was difficult. It was close. We had both city newspapers, both dailies were against us. All three television stations were against us, and the downtown business community was very much against us. Now you think they only invented it. Form a committee called the Committee to Save the Market, which ran in offices at 83 Pike Place upstairs in the Chicago New Market. And they went around saying they were the people that were there to save the market. They were the committee to save the market. And you could save the market by voting no on the initiative. And a lot of good people became very confused. I had good friends who'd come say, who really is trying to save the market? And say, look at your side, see which side he's on. And I think that was finally enough to start it. In our ads, and campaign material, we relied on Victor's images, his sketches, his language, his identity. So finally it passed by about 3-2. And I would just say, in conclusion, that even though the Ullman administration fought us tooth and nail throughout the initial battle, and Jim Brayman was the head of DCD at the time, on the evening of the initiative passed, Jim Brayman came to the Allied Arts meeting where we were celebrating our victory, he thought, and he had wrapped his wrists in gauze and remember they would catch up or something. And he came in kind of showing his fat wrist. And then he put in a big smile. He came around. And the city, of course, became one of the great helps and advocates and partners in the efforts to create the things. So I think I should stop and say.
There's Bruce Chapman. Bruce was elected to city council. Bruce will talk about elected city officials' view of what was going on. Also, Bruce is responsible for putting together about a 10-minute movie of the market in the early 70s. He's brought his video along, so we're going to watch that. But I haven't seen it, but I'm anxious to see it. So Bruce will get the video.
It's interesting for me to hear Jerry on this. I came in to the issue of the Pike Place Market, I guess, in two capacities. One is I was a member of Allied Arts, and secondly, I ran for city council in So we benefited from all of that coming together in a great concatenation. I'm not sure what it all proves, except that I've had people come here, and I've walked to give visitors a tour, and they say, well, what is this? Is this socialism? Is this private enterprise? Is this mercantilism? Is this populism? I say, yes, it's all of those things. It's an amazing hot house concoction.
accept this, this life that's on.
Bob Champion, who's in the audience, was a classmate of mine in architecture, and I wanted to just comment about Victor Steinblum, because there was an interesting thing going on in architectural education at the time. We were students during, in the 1950s, we started architecture around 1955, and Vic Steinblum, of course, was one of our teachers along with Wendell Levin and others on the faculty. And Vic was a very, obviously, those of you that knew him more, he was a very complex guy. He was a modern architect. There are some excellent, particularly residential works in Seattle that he did that are very much contemporary Northwest architecture. And there was no question about his design orientation, and in the entire school at the time was pretty much focused on the international style, on the Bauhaus, and our teaching pretty much followed that kind of structure, which I won't get into. But in architectural theory, Vic introduced to us in the mid late 50s, I guess, for the first time really, a discussion of the historic qualities of the buildings in Seattle. And we had never really looked, I had never looked at them. And in fact, we completely disassociated, in many ways, or I did at least, our history courses from our design courses. There just was no relationship between looking at Chartres Cathedral and designing buildings. And it wasn't until Vic introduced this somewhat, I think, kind of informally, that we, it really opened our eyes. And it was from then on that a number of us, I think, were committed to this idea that Seattle had something to offer from the past. There was another thing about him. He was very, obviously, very passionate. He was very positive. And I left Seattle for 15 years and moved back 2 years ago. And I must say that one of the things that I've been disappointed about the last few years is that many people that are involved in some of the kinds of issues in Seattle that we were previously do take it from a very negative stance and aggressively sort of don't do this. And I think that Vic, as aggressive as he was a very optimistic, very positive person. And I think that was certainly one of the reasons for the success of the initiative in that direction. One of the things that's nice about coming back to Seattle, and in fact now I live in Daddy Rieger, right near the market, is that it was all successful as far as I'm concerned. We can nitpick lots of things maybe about it, but it's just what we meant it to be in the early 70s. Looking back through some of the documents that established or were the framework for the guidelines and for the urban renewal plan, and there are maybe three sort of main issues that I wanted to comment on. The urban renewal plan and the historic district ordinance kind of established the framework upon which we then developed design guidelines and made decisions. And there are some of the wording in the ordinance as well as in the urban renewal plan, I think, is very interesting because it was able, I think, to convey the kind of spirit and the quality that we were charged with essentially implementing or overseeing. My own interpretation of this is that one of the issues, of course, that we were very much committed to was a concept of continuity, that there was a historic distinctive area focusing on the Central Market buildings, which, although humble and anonymous in character, are an example of servicing and adjusting to the varied and varying characteristic marketing activities. The central building spaces are particularly unique in form and character, having grown to their present form through years of anonymous and functional creation to conform to the changing market activities, always serving low-income consumers along with other special needs of the public. The district possesses integrity, though they misspelled it, of location, original construction use, and of feeling and association. I think that, I was touched by just the way this ordinance is phrased and essentially the responsibility is put on it. I would also, to pick up on a couple other points, there's then a set of urban design objectives in the urban renewal plan. And in those, the objectives are also, I think, carry on the same spirit. I'll just read a couple of them. They talk about the need to achieve compatible relationships between rehabilitated buildings and new structures. The material and the detailings of all new construction shall blend into the character of the historic district and have qualities which will visually demonstrate the passage of time, which I thought was interesting, without compromising the required performance of the material. I think the suggestion is that we use materials that would age well and that would show their age while still being lasting, though the architects that did the work there can reinterpret that maybe. And to perpetuate a market environment which encourages the contributions of individuals as a source of diversity, social vitality, and visual energy. And there are a number of other statements that are similar to that. It's the work here is looking at. The last thing I wanted to comment on very quickly is that while I was on the commission, I was also developing a plan for the Denny regrade in the late 60s, early 70s. And one of the objectives there was to develop a similar kind of community in the regrade of work, living, and leisure. Interestingly, at the time, even though there were a large number of residential units from the 1920s, the zoning ordinance did not allow the construction of any new residential development. It was entirely a commercial zone. So one of our charges was to develop a plan for the regrade, which I have to see it, that would essentially, it started, by the way, in Virginia, so it was the plan that helped establish the location for the kinds of residential units that then have developed in Virginia North. The plan called for a great deal of public amenities and about 7,000 dwelling units, and new ones, and I believe there's been about 4,000, close to 4,000 probably built now. So I think it's contributed significantly probably to the whole spirit of the market and continuing that attitude, even though obviously there's a very good mix of residential.
You expressed some interest in talking about how we're making this year hands on that $40 million. Is that the number?
Well, that's what it came to be at the end. We started with 21 million for 22 acres. and started down. There was urban renewal funding, and Bruce was making some overview observations when we were getting our notes together, and saying that there was a great deal of luck and this project coming along at the right moment in time. In 1966, the federal government established the historic preservation ordinances, the historic preservation programs nationwide. So there was a framework within which Victor could do some of his initial work. And it set up some protections for historically designated places, but also it said that if you're going to make any changes, then you have to have a historic preservation plan. So that became assistant manager and the manager, was that we were constantly getting waivers. And fortunately, we had a sympathetic administration on the corner. And the fact that this was a citizen initiative with a very strong vote behind it gave people political courage to do a lot of stuff that they would not otherwise have undertaken. So I think that the files probably had waivers on every square inch of the 7 acres as to how the federal money could be used and how it could be combined with other resources. And urban renewal was coming to an end, and I believe that this was one of the last urban renewal projects initiated in this country. And it is said that Mr. Ehrlichman had a lot to do with, he was a lawyer from Seattle area, gone off to the White House, getting that in place for the business community here. Then the question is, we had to keep part of it, but we had to bend it and shape it in a completely different direction. And because the renewal projects were closing down around the country, there got to be a flow of unused funds. And so our regional office of the Department of Housing and Urban Development was really good at snagging funds from Alaska, California, you know, any place that might be shutting the project down. And they had federal dollars that could be spent, and they knew we had a good running program here. We funneled it in. And that's part of how we wound up being close to $40 million that went into it, which is regarded as a real bargain today. It would take a great deal more. But that legal framework and flow of funds was really critical. And some of what we had to do was to keep the businesses going, because as Lee was saying, the documentation goes toward preserving the use, preserving the community, preserving the market function. And in my experience in real estate development before and since my endeavors here, I think that this piece of territory probably has the most restrictive, the deepest controls I've seen anywhere. And arguably, they're unconstitutional. But because people agree that it is something they want to do and nobody really wants to take on the battle of fighting it, it works. You know, and same is true of Carmel, California, where they're very intense guidelines, then they work because everybody lives by them, even though they're incredibly restrictive. So trying to preserve uses and textures and things was very difficult. The question has to be, how do you keep the market alive and completely rebuild it? And there were some very talented people that were on the staff, and one could get a grid of how much vacancy was in different buildings, what were the kinds of uses that were core and would need to be moved and relocated. And they came up with the notion of taking the sanitary market, which was a fairly simple, straightforward structure from First Avenue as well as Pike Place. It had a number of businesses that just wanted to take their urban renewal relocation payment shut down. There were people who were retirement age and had been waiting for the storms to settle over their businesses. And so it left a lot of vacancy, and we could use the federal money to create an interim relocation site. So essentially cleaned the place up, and it took a lot of arm twisting with the fire department, the sanitation people, the health department, to take this really pretty derelict structure and say, we're just going to use it as an interim location. Let us do just a paint-up, fix-up, clean-up, and do some fundamentals to the sanitary conditions. And move in the markets, fish markets, you know, dry goods, it's one of those goodies. But it, I think that the process worked because we had this change of resources. We had a credible program that was able to attract dollars. And we spent a huge amount of time developing the urban renewal plan, the historic preservation plan. So there was a large degree of consensus and a great degree of communication. So sometimes if a pot of money would become available or an idea, a piece of property we didn't expect to be able to buy for a long time, but became available, we could act fairly quickly because there was a kind of confidence between the commission, the merchants association, and all those involved. And there were a lot of people in Seattle that were aware of the market, involved in the campaign, that signed one or more petitions through the course of decades. And what we found when we started doing the detailed planning is that we lost a lot of interest. We'd have these workshops, and not a lot of people would come, but it became so arcane and intricate, and we had our own code words, humble and anonymous, for all kinds of things. A certain number of people knew what was humble and anonymous and what was vague and ridiculous. And you take that out of the street, and not too many people would be able to tell the difference. But it got to be a core group of people who really could function. And we got to making decisions really quickly and applying with confidence and got a lot done. And spent a lot of money with, I think, magnificent results. And I think that Pike Place will be heralded in the annals of urban planning in the future as people look back and see that this was one of the first mixed use and mixed income neighborhoods in America. I don't think that there was any place else where within a couple of blocks you had single room occupancy, low income housing, Section 8, 221D3, you name it, we had the lowest income people next to shock $100,000 condominiums. At the time those first condominiums opened, the banks didn't believe a jumbo loan was $100,000 or more. They thought no one in the world would pay $100,000 for a place to live. And the fact that he had these in such tight proximity was really quite remarkable. And what held it together was the commerce of the market, because every income level, every social level could relate to it. So it truly was a long term in America.
Can I just make a quick question here? Just to, I know the answer, but this was one of the first environmental impact statements under the new law. Tell people how long it was. You wrote it.
12 pages. So we found out that was one of the things we had to do because it was federal money and all that. It was just kind of, but nobody.
work, and I retained a Victor Steinbrook, who was not public, but an architect of the market, because it was actually, I retained as a consultant for the historic home, and I started working with, what was her name?
Lisa.
Anyway, and they did a beautiful historical inventory throughout the market, Victor sketches, also photographs, major detail. Because when you start to have demolition, if you don't have a record, you can't go back and rebuild something because it's there anymore. And we had simulated as-built drawings, because the drawings were, that we had written accurate, but we made what we call the simulated as-built drawings, with a grid on it that gave us north, south, east, west, and numbers from 0-0. And we pinpointed everything that we did as a historical element within that grid and from these various levels. And I think that we also had a group called the Market Rats, who went through the market, through under architect Mike Bush, market people like Billy Cameron on it. And they went through and got all the information into working with structural people to eliminate the blind things that happened, especially during the restoration of the historical homes and buildings. There were 14 different buildings. We filled out a very material thing to think of. And some of them were not great, not at the code. anything other than that same kind of monolithic, called the chewing gum circuit. So we put in another chewing gum circuit. I suggested some tile. I did get some tile next to the stalls, but I had some other designs and was all the same. Later on, of course, it came back and dialed, so I can do some improvement on what I thought I could improve. Two trending for the downwind carriage of the market, but it is what's up.
There's chewing gum on it. George, I wonder, you could mention some of those remarkable structural problems you found. The beams that didn't reach posts and the posts didn't reach the ground and wires and.
Flower Row was an example. Look, I don't know if you, it's hard to picture how it was before restoration, but it had very slimly columns. The inside columns were the same size as the outside columns, which were not really supporting the capital. And it had been condemned as a massive earthquake on the internet for the earthquake for the health code department. And digging down and checking some of the columns, we found them just suspended above the foundation.
You said angel wings were holding it up.
Right.
rents were a very sensitive issue, and that's why a lot of public dollars went into the preservation construction of buildings. What we've not accounted for when people figured out what were those lease contracts was that shortly thereafter was the huge energy crisis. Utilities doubled, tripled, and some of these were rents where utilities were included. And so the public corporation that owned and operated the market really got caught in a squeeze of how you maintain the
exception to something here. Go back in the history, some of the hotels were sort of sideline brothels. They had speakeasies, and many of the merchants, vegetable merchants, somebody would go in and kind of wink at them, and they'd reach down and drop a bottle in the sack of the vegetables. And there were all kinds of shady things happening in the market.
But they were humble and anonymous.
Drugs, so I understand lots of drugs were dispensed a little bit like the old speakeasy days.
And the LaSalle Hotel rented their rooms by the hour.
Yeah. So the strip places across the street are not inconsistent. So and then they dance all about the economy, and it was just a mixture of the CD and the sane and the insane. building from the parking lot?
It'll take the whole.
It's the block where the porno shops are right now.
Between Pike and Pine, first and second.
Yeah, it'll take care of the, so what is the?
The gateway.
The gateway.
And so is the Doyle Road.
The gateway.
Gateway.
So it's from Pine and First, not Pike.
Well, between, it's the block between Pike and Pine.
Pike and Pine.
And First and Second.
Second, most of the block.
The whole block?
Most of.
Except for the gateway.
Gateway and the Doyle.
Someone would be a better neighbor than many of the crime attracting places that are over there now.
I guess, I could see a library that was an extension of the market, so. And who said the library has to look like a big monument? Well, let the city grow up. I mean, the city actually has been pretty good about some things since the market broke. And there's no reason why we have to have this idea that, that large volume buildings have to be dead on the street, and they should be alive on the street. It would be a continuation of the market. That way, it would be it could be a real addition of people. That library downtown is thronged with the citizenry of Seattle, and they make good guests, and they could use the market shop here.
It's also one of the friendliest places downtown for poor people.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
It's out of town architecture that you're gonna have to deal with.
Pardon me?
It's out of town architecture you're gonna have to deal with from New York.
Right, that's right.
One of those devils.
Have they been, have they selected someone?
No.
Pennsylvania.
But are they looking for people?
Here we go.
I'd like to make a comment that the people who are on the current commission, it was interesting putting together the guidelines and the plan, and Victor Steinberg was a stern taskmaster, and as you can see from some of the language that's in the ordinance, but that was very thoughtfully crafted, and I think paragraph after paragraph of the guidelines were thought over to figure out just what did you say and what did you do. And what, there are many things that are remarkable about the plan here. One of them is that he was never amended, and that there are summer renewal plans that are that deep because there were constant amendments. And I think that the compressed time, it was about 10 years that the main market and around properties were redeveloped. And actually the city put out a very good report. Arnie, you were talking about what happened. This final report was done in 83, 84, and I think it's a very fine cap track of who did what when. And so the final report they did.
What is that entitled?
It's
final
called
report.
The final report. There are several copies of that still at the Office of Urban Conservation. So it's really quite a very good document, and it talks about pedestrian traffic and the downturn. And so I thought that is really just quite a good piece to look at. But Victor was real strong when we were debating out some things. Should we establish some general concepts that would then allow for interpretation and flexibility over the course of time? And he was very frank and saying, I don't trust him. I know what we want to do now. I want to write it as tight and specifically as possible. We had two alternate drafts throughout the general one, went for the specifics, and I think it sounds like it's held up quite well.
Although you say it's only, I think
it's unconstitutional. Because it says, because it gets down, it had to be owner occupied.
Yeah.
I don't think that's generally an enforceable thing. But it's a consensus that we agree to live by.
Well, things change a little when we were working out the amended urban renewal plan, but at the time we drafted the initiative, we assumed we would have a hostile city administration and hostile diverse ownership. Nobody pictured that there would be a friendly city administration and city ownership of the corporation. So that's the reason the initiative reads the right way it reads. We have a historic commission not appointed by the city council. saying, someone's got a lot of trouble to collect what seems to be kind of a history of the time, and it'd be a shame to put it away too soon.
Well, there are 17 historical photos in different places in the market now commemorating the 25th anniversary of the initiative. And the Allen Library at the University of Washington will run a 10-case exhibit of Friends of the Market material over the summer quarter.
Well,
at the Allen Library at the University of Washington.
Where is that?
It's next to the Sousa Wall. It's a new one. And then there's a series of lectures in September.
Also, in addition, most of these photographs come from the Seattle Municipal Archives, which holds about 120 boxes of the Pike Place Market records that document the history of the market as well as the redevelopment. And we're currently seeking money to process all that material and make these photographs available through a traveling exhibit that would go around the public spaces.
That's great.
I just want to say how glad I am that this event was on the videotape. So that, I mean, these are some lucky people who are here today. And I wasn't